So now that we've gotten the intros out of the way, what do you actually think about the show?
So, to talk about the show, I have to start off by talking about our intrepid hero. Right now, beginning of the show, he's just an ordinary kid, but over the course of the story, he will become the hero of demons, the scion of Onis, the Oni scion. Let's call him Oni scion, Onision Light.
Are you making another fucking Onision joke already?
Wait, did I make an Onision joke already?
You're calling him Onision.
No. I'm clearly calling him Oni scion, the scion of Onis.
Yeah, Onision.
These things don't sound anything alike. So Onision Light apparently wants to murder everyone.
See? I knew it!
His first line in the show is about how the world is corrupted and needs cleansing.
Yeah, all those fucking meat eaters.
People always tell me that this anime is a tense psychological thriller, but honestly it's just an edgy angst fest that wants to be more clever than it is.
Yeah, pseudo-intellectual, just like Onision.
I have no idea why you would bring him up. He has nothing to do with this.
Fucking damn it.
I mean, the protagonist opens by being like, I hate everyone and they should all be bit to death and I'm perfect at everything and everyone should love me. Don't even pretend it's not an edgelord central.
No, it absolutely is. This reads like a fucking fanfiction.
So, Onision Diet finds a book on the floor. It's a notebook and the show is called Death Note, so unsurprisingly it's called The Killer Book. See, people are gonna think that this is some kind of dumb joke, but later in the show, maybe it's just the translation I had, but characters do just refer to it as the killer book.
They do.
Despite the fact that it has Death Note written on the front cover.
It does.
I think it's kind of like the zombie thing, where no one ever refers to them as zombies, but that's because zombies don't usually have zombie printed on their forehead.
You still know what they are, though. Like, everyone's heard of what a zombie is at this point.
We're not using the Z word! So, Onision Chunky reads the book he's found. And it says, you can bip people by writing their names in the book, along with a bunch of arbitrary specific rules on how to use it. So, Onision Chunky Monkey plays about with it, and works out it actually works, and he can bit people now just by knowing their names and faces. In addition to that, he also gets an invisible gay clown who follows him around.
It's Vladimir Putin.
It is Vladimir Putin. I mean, let's be perfectly honest, it's not like there are any other invisible gay clowns floating around.
I beg to differ. There's a movie about one coming out pretty soon.
No. I'll have you know that while Pennywise was still just a blob of ink in Steve King's pen, Vladimir Putin was being an invisible gay clown stalking presidents at Disneyland.
He did!
So Onision Crunch naturally decides to watch the news to hear the name of random criminals so he can murder anyone who's ever been accused of a crime. Seems fair. News stations never get details wrong or falsely accuse people who haven't committed crimes after all.
Right, but like anybody who's convicted of a crime obviously must be guilty of it.
This, of course, leads to my personal favourite scene in the show, where Onision Budget dramatically writes in the Death Note.
That is a really good scene. It's so amazing.
He writes like 400 names in the Death Note in one sitting too.
He does.
I had no idea Japanese news channels published the names of so many criminals every evening.
Apparently they just have entire channels dedicated to that alone.
Seriously. Do we want to talk about the math on this?
Okay, yeah. Let's go ahead and break it down. Lev. So how many people, on average, does Onision Sparkle do in the 5-year span that he had the Death Note in this entire series?
So I did a little bit of counting, and the number of lines on a sheet in the show changes, but approximately it seems to average about there being space on each page for 100 names. And it's confirmed later in the show that he does 4 pages a day consistently.
Yes.
So it's 400 names a day. So yeah, it's about 100 names per page, and it's 4 pages a day. So he's consistently killing 400 people a day.
Yes.
And he does that for 5 years.
Yes, every day for 5 years.
Every day for 5 years. We'll call it 400 days in a year. So that's 2,000 days total. 400 times 2,000 is a lot. It's like 800,000. He kills, like, 800,000 people.
That's almost a tenth of the entire population of Tokyo.
Yes, yes it is.
That's the entire population of Atlanta twice.
That's more than all of the 10 smallest countries' populations in the world.
Yes.
So that's, like, 10 countries' worth of people.
Yes.
He kills off, I believe it's a fifth of the world's total criminal population.
Yes. 1 in 5 criminals have died to Onision diet.
I have so many questions.
1 in 10 people in Tokyo have died to Onision diet.
1 in 10 people in Tokyo has died to Onision rocky roads. So the police notice that a bunch of criminals all simultaneously had a heart attack and decide that they should begin an investigation into what's happening. So they hire Ella, the world's greatest detective. It's raining death and they want to hide under their umbrella. Ella.
A.
Also, by the way, technically, L is the 3 greatest detectives in the world. I'd say we'll get to that later, but we won't get to that later. We don't have enough time to get to that. So L is the first big issue that I take with this show, apart from all the other big issues I talked about, for a lot of reasons. Firstly, show don't have. L is apparently the world's greatest detective. 3 greatest detectives. The reason this is an issue is that we never see L successfully solve a crime. I mean, spoilers for when we talk about Case Closed in about 3 years' time, but the reason it's so easy to accept that the protagonist of Case Closed is a brilliant detective is that the very beginning of the first episode, before the intro music kicks in, you see him solve a case.
He solves it fairly, with evidence.
And all the evidence is presented to the audience before he solves the case.
Yes.
So you see him make a logical deduction in an unbelievably quick time, and this makes you go, yeah, he seems like a brilliant detective. By comparison, we never see L detecting anything. People always make fun of James Bond movies because they regularly begin with some over-the-top scene of James Bond blowing up an aircraft carrier while skiing down the side of a mountain on a pair of severed arms or something, but it's actually kind of a good thing. It sets up, this guy is a spy and he does cool things.
It does. It demonstrates what he does.
It does. And then you don't have to rely on word of mouth.
Yeah, you don't have to ask somebody what that character does for a living.
Imagine if you replaced these scenes with two guys you don't know sitting around talking about how James Bond is a great spy, and then you spend 20 episodes watching him not be a spy, and then he dies.
Yep.
That's my first major problem with L.
Yeah.
Imagine if you had a scene where two characters were talking and one of them said, hey, I hear that great detective L is on the Kira case. And then the other guy goes, oh, L, isn't he the guy that solved the case of the rotten tomato? And then you go, oh, okay, so he solved the case before, and that's already a better setup for him being a detective.
Yeah, that's already like 10 times better, because you have an example.
Absolutely. The next problem is going to sound weird after all of that explanation, but L just automatically knows everything.
He does.
I know I just said he's not a very good detective, but there's a difference between detecting and omniscience.
Yeah, he just metagames the whole thing.
He does. So L shows up on TV and declares himself to be called Lindor, and that he will find the murderer who has been creatively named the Kanto Decapitator.
I wish he was the Kanto Decapitator. That sounds way better.
I wish he was called the Kanto Decapitator. JK, they named him Killer.
Kira.
That's just racist, Mandy. They called him Killer. So, to demonstrate his commitment to the fine moral code he's indicated that he has before this point of only killing criminals, Onision Code Red immediately murders Lindor. But oh ho ho, it was a ruse! It turns out that it was just some random guy named Lindor, and L is actually someone else. And now L has confirmed his suspicions that Killer needs to know someone's name and face in order to kill them. Now, if you're anything like me, you might be wondering, but how did he rule out biological warfare, chemical warfare, conspiracy within the police force, misinformation by news networks, conspiracy within higher government, and why did he just immediately jump to he's killing people by magic?
I don't know. I really honestly don't know. He's talking shit.
Yeah, that's RL. If you start out by assuming you know how everything works, then you know how everything works. if anything, this particular display should really just make people suspect L, honestly.
Yeah, because he seems to be making up the rules here.
I mean, what's more likely, that there's a murderer that has a magical power that they need to know your name and face in order to magically kill people in a world where magic doesn't exist? Or that the world's self-proclaimed greatest detective killed a guy on stage in order to make himself look like a brilliant detective? Way more plausible than what L is claiming.
Yeah.
Honestly, if this happened in the real world, in modern day, where this show is set, I'm pretty sure everyone would decide it was a viral marketing campaign for the next season of Game of Thrones. So now L knows what killer needs to kill people. And more importantly, because he only broadcast this in a limited area, he's ruled it down to the Kanto region of Japan, meaning the killer has to be one of the original 152 Pokemon. Hey Mandy, what kind of Pokemon do you think Killer is?
Well, since he seems to be some indestructible, omniscient being, I would say Mewtwo.
That's a pretty good call. I was thinking, because he kills people with apparently the power of his mind, he's probably like a psychic type, like a Kadabra or a Mr. Mime.
Or a Mewtwo.
Or a Mewtwo. How about an Exeggcute?
The fucking egg?
I mean, he executes people.
I can't. Get out.
I mean, are you really gonna throw me out before I've made my racist Jinx joke?
Yes!
So now that Killer's location has been pinned down to a relatively small region of the world, it's time to bring in the FBI. What's wrong with Japanese law enforcement, you ask? Would the FBI even have jurisdiction in Japan? Do they have a policy regarding what's already been decided to be magic killing? Actually, interestingly enough, the Department of Justice do have a policy which suggests that they consider themselves to have jurisdiction anywhere in the world, whether or not other countries think they do, which was a policy laid down under former President Bush. I know American politics.
Yeah, you do.
Regardless, it's really not obvious why the FBI is involved in what appears to be a Japanese mass murderer.
I have no idea.
I mean, sure, they killed a lot of people, but based on the implication, they only killed Japanese people.
True.
I mean, Americans don't care if you kill Japanese people.
Wow!
Unless you do it by flying them into the side of American boats.
Wow! Okay.
Too soon, guys?
Time to stop!
Meanwhile, the Japanese police force is in shambles as they try to decide who is brave enough to stay working for the police force. It turns out there's 5 of them, including the chief of police, who is Onision Badger Blast's father.
Badger Blast.
Detective Unagi.
Badger Blast.
Yes, Onision Badger Blast. Man, something about the character names in this show makes me really hungry. I don't know what it is about Onision Peanut Brittle and Detective Unagi.
The world may never know.
Let me just go through all the other important detectives, see if any of them also make you feel hungry. There's Unagi and Satsuma and Sushi and Cannon Fodder 1, Cannon Fodder 2.
I mean, nothing makes me more hungry than cannon fodder.
Oh man, I just love the smell of fresh cannon fodder in the morning. Particularly that cannon fodder number 2. Actually, I've done the cannon fodder number 2 in the morning, it's not pleasant.
Ew.
So it's around this point in the show where it suddenly occurred to me that this show is just stupid Dexter.
What?
So does the police chief, makes it his mission in life to murder all the criminals that are getting away with their crimes, only he has no evidence. He's most likely killing people who are already in prison, and he repeatedly makes critical errors that make him easier to find.
Oh my god.
It's stupid Dexter.
Oh my god, it is stupid Dexter.
Want to know what stupid Dexter does next?
What?
Well, so far we're only on episode fucking 3, so why not check out the rest of the show while you wait?
Fuck me.
Link in the description below. Do yourself a favor. Don't click it. Don't click it.